fit between polygons and animations using your F2, F3, F4 to go to surfaces, or F5 to go to dynamics. So what we are going to use today is polygons, which will be your F3. Okay, so once you get to polygons, you'll see that you are given a set of menu, a different set of menu compared to animation per se. Alright, so let's go back to polygons. This is where we will use most of our tools. So next, this is your viewport, and on your top right corner, this is your the view cube, as referred by Autodesk. Okay, if you can't find your view cube, you can go to display, and let's see, heads up display, view cube. Alright, this will toggle it on and off. Alright, so next thing is of course the sidebar here, where you have your pointer tool. This is your lasso tool. This is to allow you to select faces or vertices using irregular shapes. Alright, this is your paint tool, paintbrush, where you can select based on painting. And of course your move tool, rotate, scale, and manipulator, I think, whichever one. Alright, so this is the basic, really basic stuff that we are gonna look at. Now, there are some folks who prefer to look at the different viewports, so you can toggle your viewports using your spacebar. So quickly hit on your spacebar and you can toggle between each viewport where your mouse cursor moves to. Alright. And the other way of navigation is by really just hold down your spacebar and not release it. This will give you all the menus in Maya. So if you click on Maya, left mouse click and hold, you will be able to see your perspective, top, side, and front. Okay, so you will be able to change the different viewports. So first of all, we are going to create a cube. Alright. Now there are two forms of creating your geometry. Alright. There's a interactive creation, and if I were to uncheck, alright, and let's say I click on cube, immediately it's gonna give me the cube. Alright. It's gonna create a cube for me based on the units one by one by one. Some people like it, some people don't. Personally, I prefer to create it based on my own assumptions. So I'm just gonna check this back on and create a cube. Now, while holding X, you're gonna see this being highlighted. This is gonna tell you that snap to grid is toggled on. So I'm just gonna hold down my X, and while holding down my X, I'm going to left mouse click and drag. This is to make sure that the points of my cube is gonna snap to my grid. So once you release, you're gonna get this face or this square, alright, and you're gonna see your icon change to a direction going upwards. This is to tell you to indicate the height of the cube. So left mouse click and drag and you'll get the height. Now once you get this cube on your right panel, you're gonna see translate XYZ. This is basically your position of the cube, rotate as indicated by an angle. Okay, and scale is always 1 by 1 by 1. If you want it to be smaller, it will be less than 1 or going increasing the size would be bigger than 1. Now, how do we change the dimensions of our cube? We can go and look at inputs. Alright, inputs, you can see my polycube 1. Click on polycube 1. And you're going to see width, height, and depth. So I can always change this to say 12 instead of my 17. Okay, or you can change it one by one, or you can left mouse click and drag upwards, and you're going to see this highlighted. And once that is highlighted, you can input any numbers, and once you hit enter, it will change for the rest of the attributes. This is what we call attributes. Alright, so we're going to look at how else we can navigate in our viewports. Right now in this viewport, you are looking at line work. This is what we call wireframe, wireframe viewport, or wireframe mode. Alright, you can see it from here, okay, this little icon here. Or if you hit number 4 is your wireframe mode. So if you hit number 5, and just observe what happens when I hit number 5, okay, it changes to this icon, and now I have a shaded mode on my cube. Alright, this is the shaded mode. And the next thing, sometimes if let's say I deselect my, you can deselect the object by clicking anywhere within the viewport. So by deselecting the object, I'm just going to see my cube in shaded mode. But sometimes I would like to look at my shaded mode with wireframe. So how do I go about doing it? So if you look at this wire, look at this icon, wireframe unshaded, click on it, and you'll see the blue color wireframe over my gray shade on the cube. And of course, the next one with the checkers. This is your texture. And right now, because we do not have a texture, so you can disregard that and toggle back off. Alright, so this is just a basic navigation. And we are going to start creating our little house or simple house. Now, when we are doing models for, or 3D models for games or for any of the industry, perhaps in film or in broadcast design, it is always best to keep your object four-sided. What I mean is, if I look at this square, it's four-sided, right? So every face, this is what we call face. Alright, every face will have four edges. Alright, so this is what we call bisides. So we need to have four edges for each face. Okay, this is a face. And if we were to look at where your edges will meet or intersect, this is what we call vertex points. Alright, so you can right click mouse over your object and right click and hold. You're gonna see edge, object mode, vertex, and face. So if I select face, and if I mouse over any face, you're gonna see that it's it will highlight in red, and when I click on it, it's gonna turn to green, or well, when mouse over or when you move away, it's gonna be orange. Alright, this is face. And if I right mouse and hold again, go to edge, and I can do the same, right? And of course, my vertex. And when I want to get out of my object, right, because right now it's in selection, and if I were to try to click anywhere within my viewport, it is still in that component mode, which means it's either in vertex or face or edge mode. So in order to get back as an object, I need to right click and hold and select object mode. Okay, so that way now if I were to select the object again, I can move it around. So if let's say I go back to vertex, now I cannot select the object and move. Okay, because if I were to select the, let's say, the vertex and I move it, it's just going to move that one vertex. Alright, so now that we are clear about making sure that our model has to be four-sided, we can go ahead and look at how we can model a simple house. So first of all, when we are doing models, we need to understand what kind of model we are looking at, or what kind of image that we are trying to get that into a 3D object. So imagine you have a house or something. I'm just going to use my mouse to quickly paint this, so it's not going to be good looking. So let's say I want a house, right? So I'm just going to do something like that. So I have a very simple house. The next thing I want to look at a house is what the shape is. That's the first thing. But before that, again, when we look at any kind of object, we need to be very sure on the details of our object. So let's say, for example, if I were only to create this house, I gotta make sure that my supervisor or some my client is not gonna tell me all of a sudden that I need my character to go into the house. Okay, because if we were to build this house, there's like maybe a door, but there is no interior. Okay, so basically, if I were to look at this from the top view down. It's basically just gonna look like that, and this is a roof, and it's just gonna look as squarish as that. There is nothing else. And if we were to look at it from the inside, it's just gonna look like this, nothing else. However, if our client or our supervisor decides that, hey, you know, you need to create a house where the character can enter to and fro into the house, then we need to build walls, we need to build doors, we need to build windows. Okay, then that's gonna be another thing. So in any case, if we were to look at this and we want to build a house that can be entered. Okay, so I will do something like this. This will give me an idea of where, of what, of how I am going to model. So let's say this is the door, okay? Windows, well, someone like it. Well, the proportion is not exactly right, but you get an idea. Okay, so I have these dark patches as my windows and my door if I were to half the house away, all right? So looking at something like this, okay, from the top view down, this will give us a basic idea of how we want to construct our house. Alright. So when we look at this, this is a cube. There is another cube inside, but we are not gonna look at that. We're gonna look at this as dotted lines first. Alright. Because these are walls and that is empty, right? So it's gonna be the same on all sides. Right? So it's gonna be the same. So I have two rectangles, and that is what I need to do in on my object. Okay, so first of all, I will squash this guy down just to create a floor. So maybe a height of 1 or maybe even less than that. So 0.2, perhaps 0.5, right? And the next thing we want to make sure is our translate x, y, and z is at 0. Alright, so once we have this, we are going to turn this into something longer. So maybe I turn this to 15. Alright. Now, if I go to my top view, this is what I'm going to look at. And if you remember what our image looks like, we have two rectangles. Alright. And in my Maya, I'm just looking at my 3D object, I'm just going to look at one rectangle. So how do I increase my rectangles, or what we call subdivisions? Alright, so if I were to increase my division, subdivision width, maybe increase it to 2, so I see this extra edge running across. So if I were to look at in my perspective view, alright, it's going to run across. So going back to my top view, so perhaps I want to have 3 instead. Okay, so I have 2, and my subdivision depth, because right now if I would look at this, this is my height. So if I were to increase this, that is my height, and that is not going to be correct. So I'm just going to leave it as 1, and increase my division to 3. Alright. So again, going back to my top view, this is what I am going to see. So going back to my image, right? So if I were to separate or even cut this out, do I have 9 squares or rectangles opposed to this guy? So I do. So right now what I can do is select this and I can move it across. But whenever we move this across, we might not be correct. So one trick or one way of moving both ends to correctly match up the thickness of this wall or this imaginary wall is to select, you can select edge, double click on it. Alright. You will select the entire ring. Okay, hold down your shift and double click again. So you will select both. So to move this correctly, I can go to my scale tool and move it across. Alright, and I'm gonna do the same for my other two edges. So going back to my top view, it's somewhat there. Of course, you can always try to be as accurate as you want. But as of right now, we are not really looking at accuracy or how many cms or how many foot. Right now, that's not our concern. Our concern is to build something that looks like a house. Or basically looks like this image. So the next thing we want to look at is the location of our window. Again, in this regard, we are doing planning. Alright, window, window, and door. Alright, and maybe opposite, I want also to have my two windows there. Alright, so I have one more here. Alright, so as I am planning, I am also creating the divisions. Alright, so in this case, right now I know that I need to have 6 more divisions. So in Maya, okay, I can select the objects. Alright, so the first tool we're going to use is in your edit mesh. It is called Insert Edge Loop. Now, if you just click on Insert Edge Loop, you can insert and drag it to any position that you want, right? So that's not what we want. At this point of time, we want to look at other stuff. In insert edge loop options. If you see this little square here, it's gonna say it's options. So once you click on it, you're gonna have this tool settings on the left panel. So what I can do is I can use multiple edge loops, and I can say I want to have 6, okay, in equal multiplier. Once I have set the number, I can click on it, and there we go. Okay, I have 6 in between. So right now I have 2 for my windows, 2 for my doors, and another 2 for my windows. Okay, and of course at this point, however you want to shift it, it's really up to you. So what I'm gonna do is maybe I want to move it somewhere there, and for my doors, actually gonna need it to be bigger. Okay, so maybe somewhat there, or maybe a little bigger. Okay, so once I have this, all right, going back to my image. This is from my top view, alright? Top. So I'm gonna look at my front view, which is which I have my windows and my doors. So front view looking would be something like well, something like this. Would be the roof. It's not gonna be really accurate, but it's just for visual reference. And I have my window. So this will be my front. All right. So looking at my front view, I will need to have these are my end divisions. Okay. So I have one window, door. Okay. This is exactly the same as what's going on here. All right. So right now we need to look at a side. And we need to look at a shape. Okay, so this is my roof. Okay, so what we are gonna build is we're gonna build up to this, where before we move onto the roof. Okay, so this is our base. This is our well, top of our house before the roof. Then we need to have 2 more in between. This will be for our window. So going back here, I'm going to move and select my faces on the sides. Okay, so I select this entire side, or if I want to, I can deselect the door, because if I were to look at this in the image again, the door itself, it starts out from the base where it's gonna be empty, because the door itself would be a separate object. Okay, so I am going to go to my edit mesh and use something called extrude. Alright, so when I look at extrude, I can move it up or do whatever I want. At this point of time, if I were to extrude just like this, it's gonna move in the direction of where your face, the face of the object is facing. Okay, the facing direction. So if I were to click on this radial point, it's gonna move according to the direction of my manipulator. So in this case, I'm just gonna move it up to where the window is. Okay, so this is a part. So the next thing that I need to deselect, if you can guess, would of course be my windows. All right. So I will do an extrude again. a rather small house. Probably this you can only occupy a dog, probably. But that aside, this is how you get your extrusion. Now, the problem right now that we have is how do we connect between this? Because again, if you were to look at a house, this is fully connected. Right, so moving back to Maya. So what we can do is to select this faces. Okay, these are the faces that we do not need to have. Select all these faces and you can hit backspace or hit delete key. Alright, so once you have done a backspace or delete, which I feel that backspace is a much safer option, if you will. So you will have this empty face here. Now, in most of your models, if it is going to show a lot of details, such as high poly model, you should never try to end it with a plane like this. For some low poly models, yeah, you can definitely have it. You can imagine that as a skirt or something, that you will have an open edge here. Okay, that is fine. But in this case, we need to fill it up. Okay, we need to connect this across. So how do we connect? We can go to Edit Mesh, Append to Polygon Tool. So I click on Append to Polygon Tool. Okay, select one edge. So this edge is going to connect to this guy, to this edge. So click on the second edge. All right, and you're gonna see this nice pink color face that will connect both edges. Next thing you can do is either to hit your enter key or click on your pointer tool. Alright. Now you can again go to Edit Mesh, Append to Polygon Tool, select the two edges, enter or pointer tool. Alright. And one of the shortcut keys in Maya is a letter G. So if you hit letter G, it's going to use the last command. So this is to facilitate your efficiency when it comes to modeling. Alright. So same deal. I'm just going to do this. And let's say if you hit something incorrect, you can always do a backspace. Once you hit a backspace, basically the point that the very first point that you have selected is still selected, and all you need to do is to select the second edge here. All right. Now there is another tool that you can use other than Append to Polygon tool. It is called the Bridge. Okay, so Bridge allows you to, let's say, select two edges. All right, I have two of my edges selected, and Edit Mesh, Bridge. All right. But at this point of time, because Bridge is creating a lot of redundant divisions, this is not what we need. So a lot of times you will need to go to its options and set your divisions to 0. So once you hit Bridge, it's only one. The nice thing about Bridge is because I can do multiple selections. So let's say I select the opposing edges. Alright. And hit Bridge. Okay, but of course at times it's not able to calculate it correctly and it fill up the hole instead. So it depends on how you would use it. Alright, so still much easier to use a pen to polygon tool. Again, it's depending on what you're working on. So you can experiment with the tools. So I'm gonna do the same for the back. Okay, so that's the first part of building our small little, I don't know, human house, dog house, whatever you want to call it. Alright, so this is the first step that we have done so far. The first thing, especially after you have created the faces that are needed to fill the holes, the very first thing that you would want to do is check the normals of your objects. And what are normals? Normals is, you can imagine this, because a plane itself by itself is unlike a plane in the real world, like a piece of paper. The paper is double-sided, but the plane itself is not. Especially in the case of game development, when this is exported to a game engine, the face itself is only single-sided. Alright, so you need to find out whether if the faces of your object is facing the right direction. Okay, so in this case we want our faces to face outwards. Okay, only when it faces outwards then it will look correct in any of the game engine. So we can go ahead and hit display, polygons, and look at face normals. Okay, so when we look at face normals, we want to make sure that this is moving upwards, outwards, is not pointing in a different direction. Okay, so the other way that you can use is something called back face culling. So how do we really look at back face culling? Let me show you a quick example. Let me just turn this face normals off. Okay, so let's say I create a plane. And with that selected, I'm gonna turn on my face normal. So right now you're seeing this face normal and it's only pointing upwards. What happens when I move opposite? Okay, with the face selected again, all right. Display, polygons, back face culling. Alright, so when I'm behind the plane, it's no longer showing. This is exactly the same as how a game engine would take its information from. With this, this is the direction where it's pointing. This is the face we will be looking. Alright, so this is how you need to be conscious whenever you work on your models. Okay, so coming back to our model, let's look at this again. For example, if let's say I want another window right in the middle of my house, okay, towards the back. So what can I do about it? Right now, I can always select this face, this two face. Hit my backspace to get rid of them, and maybe at this point of time I want to toggle off my back face culling, so I need to go to polygons, sorry, display, polygons, back face culling again to because at times you might not be able to use your tools correctly with backface calling. Now, as you increase the number of faces here, you're gonna see some weird stuff in your model, like these black color edges. Now, these black color edges is telling you something. Alright, so a couple of things that these black faces will or black edges will tell you is either there is a problem with your faces, or it's simply because the normals have a little softened to simulate softness or simulate roundness. So a better way probably to explain this concept is if, let's say, I had to create a spear. Alright, so if I were to take away my wireframe on shaded mode, if I were to look at the spear, it looks perfectly round and nice on this object. Okay, so if I were to go to my normals, alright, I'm just gonna click on that to tear it away. We're gonna look at something called soften and harden edge. Okay, with my spear selected, I am gonna hit harden edge, and I need to deselect my spear. So I click anywhere around my empty viewport, and I am going to see many facets on the spear. It makes your edge a lot sharper. Okay, so this is called hardened edge. Of course, you can select your edges and turn it to soft again. It's really based on your selection. So as of now, I'm just gonna select this object, and I set it to soften edge again, deselect, and there we go. Alright, this will soften up a lot more. So in this case, I can always select the edge. Okay, so if I hit F, I'm able to move it closer, because if I were to look at this now, it looks rather strange. So maybe I select the four edges and I hit harden edge, and there we go, it looks much better. Okay, so in this case, a house really I'm not building an organic house, so I'm just gonna select this entire house and hit harden edge. Alright, so now I have one door and five windows, and if I were to again check on my house again, if I were to look at the faces, each face, it is still four-sided. Alright, so the next thing that I want to do, going back to my image, I'm gonna look at the side view. Okay, so looking at the side view, first of all, I have this wall at the side, okay, which is the rectangle. So, oops. So I'm just gonna draw a rectangle side and a triangle. Oops. Okay, so something like this. Really excuse my drawing. Alright, so this is the side view. Alright, so this is how it's gonna look like, and this is where we have ended. So we need to create a triangle rooftop. So before we build our specific roof, we need to make sure that this is constructed in such a way that there's a triangle at the side. So going back to our 3D model, we need a triangle, and at this point of time, we are lacking a division. Okay, so what we can do again, insert edge loop tool. Alright, I want to make sure that it's in equal distance, so I set it to 1, use equal multiplier, click on this, and immediately I'm gonna get this line right across in the middle of my object. Right. So why do I want to do this? So right now if I go to my side view, right, in my side view, I'm gonna select my vertex and select these vertices. So in my perspective view, these are the 4 vertices that will be selected. So the next thing, I can move it up, or well, to whatever angle that you want your house to be. Alright. Now of course there are different ways of building the roof. You can either build it with 2 additional objects, or if you want to, you can set up a base. So what do I mean by setting up a base? Now I can select these 2 or these 4 faces. Alright, hit extrude. Okay, this time around again, make sure that select the radio button. If let's say I am using this, it's gonna based on the direction at which the face it's facing. Okay, so what I really want to do is to make sure that I have equal amount of offset on my roof. Alright. So once that is done, some things that I can, again, to take notes, either I do this at one time, or right now, because due to me not planning it correctly, I'm missing out these faces. Okay, I need to also extrude the sides. Alright. So undo. Alright, so right now I need to select these faces. Oops, I might have selected more than what I need. So let me go to my front view and deselect this. Ah, much better. Okay, so I'm going to extrude again. Okay, this way. Alright, so the next thing, what's needed is to really form the shape of your house. Okay, because in my image, this is a sharp corner, right? So I will need to perhaps move this down a little bit. Alright. I'll even go to the side view to take a look whether if it looks correct. Alright. Okay, so the next thing that we want to do, well, a couple of things. You can either select these faces, okay, the opposing faces as well. Okay, this is again the slow way of doing, and I'm just gonna show you so that you can understand this a little better. So I'm just gonna delete that away. Alright, so leaving the 2 ends. And even for these 2 ends, let's see, maybe I will delete that half away. So what's gonna happen is that this face itself, okay, or perhaps, let's see, might be a good idea to delete that also. Because other than extruding faces, you can also extrude edges. So this is one thing that that is important for you to know. So let's say I extrude my edges again, select that so that I can move it across. I can always make sure that I can fit this or align this correctly later on. So what I really need to do is to make sure that I extrude this across carefully. And again, please remember whenever you extrude, please extrude it outwards so that you can see that there's a thickness. Because I have seen a lot of students that extrude twice without knowing and creating problems in their geometry at a later stage. So extrude and move it close to where the edges are. Okay, so I'm just gonna end up here. Okay, reason is because I want to make sure that the points are correct. Right? Now, because the points are so close to each other, what I can do is just to show you a quick reference on how you would combine or even make sure that the points are in fact connected together. Because if I were to move this point, you can tell that this is not connected. Okay, so what I really need to do is to marquee. This is marquee. Okay, click and drag to see that little square selection. Okay, marquee this and go to something called merge options. Okay, so in merge options, so with the default values, it is at 0.01. Okay, hit apply because these are the ones that are selected. So right now if I were to deselect, okay, and when I bef because before I test it I need to deselect first, select the point again by single clicking and move it. So now I can be very sure that my points are joined, and if I were to look at this again, this is not joined. Okay. Now, the nice thing about this is because it's based on the selection, and this is again, you can imagine this value as the distance between the vertices. So, for example, if I were to select all of this, okay, the entire roof, and if I were to increase this to 10, I hit apply, everything is going to be merged as one. But what happens if I set it to 0.01 and hit apply? Okay, so what's going to happen is if I were to select this point alone, okay, so you can tell that select this point alone and move it around, it is merge. The two vertices are merge, right? So this is itself a constraint, checking whether if they fit within this distance. So for this value, it's really your own experimentation based on how big you are building your objects. So this point of time, I will use my append to polygon tool. Select this point and do that. Okay, this is the inside of the house, and this is the outside. And again, to get rid of this black color stuff, you need to go ahead and go to normals and harden edge. All right. So of course, the next thing would be selecting the objects and go to Edit, Delete by Type History. Now, this is what we call history. And the reason why we always delete the history is because whenever Maya opens your file, it's gonna read through this entire list. And if it gets too long, Maya might crash or your file might get corrupted. So it is extremely good practice to delete your history. Alright, and of course, clicking on this object allows you to name your 3D model. And there we go, a real simple house. Okay. So again, if you want to add in additional details, it's really easy. Okay, so let's say I want something additional more here. Oops, sorry. Okay, just be careful because this will move the opposite direction. So you will need to move it accordingly. Okay. And of course, when we look at this, this is the basic structure of the house. Additional elements that you might need would perhaps, let's say, a door frame or something. So let's say I want to create a door frame. And let me move it out. Extrude this. Door frame. Alright. And of course, you can always create your doors. Although, again, do bear in mind, the direction of where your door is turning, because if I were to rotate this, it's gonna be turning the wrong, it's turning based on the center of your object. So we can change the pivot by hitting your insert key. So let's see, where's my insert key? Okay, because I'm using a laptop right now, I'm trying to find out how to toggle my insert. Oh, there we go. So once you have your insert key, again, hold down your, you can either snap to point or hold down your V key and move it to the point here and hit your insert key again. Okay, so now once you open up your door, you'll open up the right way. Okay, so basically that's it for this really, really basic house tutorial. And I truly apologize for my previous tutorials that have the